There's going to be a lot about ontologies. Thank you, Xavier, for the introduction, and thank you, everyone, for actually sticking around for all this time and still being here after three such an excellent talks. So I'm trying to wrap up and perhaps maybe apologies a bit in advance because I'm going to cover a cross-section of different topics, but there's going to be quite a few things about ontologies. But what I decided to do is to talk about this field of semantic audio. So, and this comes from the motivation of how I started my career in research. So when I started, I've seen a lot of people working on various areas in music informatics, and still to date, many people ask me, okay, what is semantic audio? Is it just a branding of something? Is it different from what people do in music information retrieval or not? Well, so hope I can actually highlight some of the differences in the approach that I'm trying to do. And the reason why I'm trying to, why I was started to working in this field is because I had quite a few ideas at the beginning of my PhD, which I quickly realized that, well, actually they are too complicated. I was coming from a background of audio engineering and was trying to do things in a professional audio engineering context. And I found that, well, it's quite difficult to deal with the errors, for instance, of the audio analysis and also all sorts of contextual information that is needed to make things work in that environment. So I probably need a bit more structure. And that's what capturing the semantics of what the algorithms do, what the actual relation of the data to the music and the data to the context and perhaps how people want to use them. So that's why it's important to actually capture a bit more precisely what do things actually describe. So perhaps a loose way of defining what semantic audio is developing a set of technologies that enable composing, producing, finding, and actually experiencing music in a more human way. So perhaps also focusing on interaction, which is a goal of a lot of the things that I've been looking at. And this is, of course, becoming especially more important with more and more technologies, digital technologies around, and lots of large collections around. So perhaps to exemplify things like that, how would we help music producers to create pieces that, or help producing pieces that are supposed to express a particular emotion? So that's, of course, a lot of that is down to the composition, but also to production. And I'm interested in capturing how things are produced and how could we help people in that area, or how could we control audio effects using semantic terms rather than having to learn the parameters of signal processing algorithms and what they actually mean. Okay, so that's just a couple of ideas about semantic audio. So the way I see it, it's essentially the intersection of, a lot of things that we do in music informatics research, but also in other areas. So perhaps somewhere between semantic web technologies and music informatics and audio content analysis, intelligent audio production, various web technologies, and natural language processing, which are components that contribute to the semantic web. So, of course, there are then lots of technologies which are involved, which makes things a little bit complicated because you have to become quite interdisciplinary to learn a bit about signal processing and machine learning on one side, learn about ontologies, logic, and reasoning on the other side, and the more underlying technologies that enable us to build the web, so protocols and data representation, languages, and so on and so forth. So I'm not going to cover all this, obviously, but try to give a couple of ideas how I put this together and how I make use of them. Okay, so the outline of the topics that I'm aiming to talk about today is in this intersection of semantic audio analysis and semantic web technologies. So firstly, I would like to talk a bit about ontology-based systems, why ontologies are important, and how they help creating interesting systems, perhaps new ways of finding music or new ways of experiencing music. Also, I got interested in music and emotion. That's perhaps one of the most complex and difficult tasks in the area of semantic audio analysis. So how do we recognize what emotion people feel when listening to a piece of music, and how could then we use this knowledge to help the production process perhaps, and also what happens in a live environment, so interactive systems perhaps which help connecting audiences with the performers in this context. And lastly, I would like to talk about semantic music production, so how would we really help then producers once we formalize, capture this information and create systems that really enable things to be controlled using semantics. And then if there is time, maybe there is a bonus topic which I may or may not cover at the end. Okay, so ontologies are often not very obvious why they are important, but just to give an example from a higher level perspective, this is a diagram that's proposed by the BBC, actually, when they were looking at how they produce content, but it's very well applicable to how music is traditionally being produced, essentially, for composition. There's a production process, there is a distribution process, and a consumption process, and this is traditionally a very linear approach, but it's starting to change. And one of the projects that I'm working on at the moment at Queen Mary, the Fusing Audience Semantics Technologies project, tries to look at what happens if we perhaps create a circle, and that's also very relevant to the Audio Commons project that Xavier mentioned. And so capturing the information in each of these stages of production and formalizing them so that we can have metadata propagated through the different stages of production is something that could perhaps enable new recommendation systems to be built based on information, let's say, who were the session musicians in the recording session. So this is information that is often lost in this traditional linear chain. So we can see that there is, perhaps this is just one example, but it's clearly easy to see that there is value in trying to learn as much of each of the stages of this production workflow, because in each stage there might be benefit to the actual stakeholder. So in production we can have benefit from learning a bit about how people consume, for instance, music, which is again something which is not really propagated back through this chain. So the idea here is that we try to formalize what people do and perhaps also what computers do in this environment using ontologies, and that will eventually enable interconnecting each of these stages. So that perhaps just an idea of why I think ontologies are important. But let's look at some definitions, because still a lot of people ask me what ontologies actually are. And there are two definitions which are important to look at. So the topic originates from philosophy, where people have been looking at theories about existence in general, how we categorize things. And it really goes back to Aristotle and even further behind. But there was a resurgence of this, of interest in this in computer science and artificial intelligence from the mid-20th century, where we can say it's essentially a formal specification of a shared shared conceptualization of a domain. So we're looking at a domain, perhaps an application. Shared conceptualization means that people should agree on how we categorize things, and that's very important because it's still quite common that people just come up with an ad hoc schema for something and then maybe wonder why people don't really want to consume data in that format, because maybe they don't agree with it. So it's important to look at multiple experts and how they might agree on things, which is sometimes difficult. So I will get back to that later, how we might be able to resolve that. And of course, there is an element of knowledge representation, which is concerned with structuring information so that some sort of formal reasoning or automated interpretation of the information becomes possible. So this is an important thing to keep in mind, because this is what sets apart using ontologies from things like object models and XML schema, which are weak conceptual models, so they don't cover a lot of the semantics of the things that we define in our area of interest. So ontologies also encapsulate this idea of providing logical constraints within our models so that we can have much better understanding about the meaning of things that we work with. But so far I've been talking about very, very high level and abstract things. So I would like to start by giving you a couple of examples of how this actually relates to music and what I'm actually really talking about. So the first video which I'm going to show is a work that emerged a couple of years after the music ontology was created at Queen Mary, particularly by colleagues Yves Raymond and Samer Abdallah and a couple of other people. I was just a junior PhD student at the time, but contributed to some of the development of these models. So those of you who are veteran music hack-takers might have seen this before, but this is a very nice example of using linked data and the music ontology to create something interesting about music. So the idea of this video is to create or simulate an artificial DJ at a radio station and see if we can create basically a radio program that gathers information from the semantic web and links various sources together to tell us about, select the music and tell us about the music.
Hello, I am the music board. I play music, and I like to tell you all about the music I play. I live on IRC. I get my information from BBC Music, BBC Programs, Last FM, The Echo Nest, Yahoo Weather, and the Web of Linked Data. To find out more, please visit bit.ly/musicboard. Now let me play you some music. Beverly Knight sounds a bit like Eternal. In September 2005, Knight joined the likes of Bob Dylan and Joni Mitchell by being made a Doctor of Music after receiving the honorary degree from the University of Wolverhampton.
We have one life to live. Take every chance we can to be happy.
Did you know that Knight, Beverly has short description soul music, which has derivative disco, which has description The Supremes? The Supremes have released 73 records. Where It In Our Love Go was just terrible. The Supremes disbanded in 1977 after an 18-year run. Alex Lester on BBC Radio 2 is a massive fan. They have been played 11 times on this show. The Supremes is quite exciting. Did you know that The Supremes lives in Detroit, and that Aretha Franklin lives in the same place?
All right, so you get the idea. there's another application I would like to talk a little bit about. This is something that we're still developing at the moment. So this is called Music Web, which allows you to navigate artists, or discover new artists perhaps, by looking at different ways of connecting them together based on both contextual metadata and cultural metadata, And also recently I've been adding parts of it which looks at their music, so actually doing content analysis based on data we get from acoustic brains. So I'm going to get back to that later. But the way it works, let's say you can choose an artist. It gathers information from different services, such as DBpedia, to get biographies, recommendations, and samples from various music providers. But perhaps the most important part of it is that it looks at categories onto which this artist can be classified, and then provides you links to similar artists. So for instance, other artists who are also on Capitol Records, other artists who are also female American jazz musicians or jazz singers, or other artists who are from Virginia, or other artists who also sing the swing. So various categories that can be gathered through artists. And what you can do is essentially navigate through them, so you can click on one of the artists and you can find more information and basically discover a network such a way. So how do these applications really work? They essentially combine information from different sources, and in order to make this possible, we need to have some sort of interoperability between these sources. So we need to be able to identify that we are talking about, let's say, cities, or we're talking about record labels, and make it somehow easier to resolve potential differences between the way people in these different data repositories usually model their schema. So one of the things that ontologies provide to the semantic web is to have some sort of common agreement about structuring our information so that we can automate how this information is linked together. Now, I know some of you are familiar with this already, but I'm supposing then for some of you this is still relatively new. Now, the problem with the traditional web services models is that data usually lives in silos, so you have some information, you might want to make it public, you create a data schema, but you decide on your data schema just by looking at your small, relatively small domain of interest. And if somebody tries to create an application that mashes up lots of data sources, you might need to resolve ambiguities in how you actually classify things, whether you used, for instance, record label or just label, so different syntactic representation of things in your data schema, or whether you actually incorporated that class at all, or you just represent it as an attribute if you're talking about artists. So all these differences would make it not impossible, but quite hard to combine different data repositories. So once we have ontologies describing these sources, the linking and the consumption of this information becomes much easier. And that's for the music domain, that's what the music ontology helps us to do. Okay, so one more detour before I would like to talk a bit more about the music ontology. Often people ask me whether linked data, the semantic web, and the web data are actually the same thing, because we often talk about this. And they are often used interchangeably. My view on it is really that linked data is essentially a mechanism for creating a web of data, and the semantic web is actually a little bit more. It's something that incorporates all these ideas about automated reasoning, but something that's very practical already and something where we have a lot of information already available is essentially data that's organized around wildly used and published ontologies, giving us the web of data. So this is something practical. This is something where we have really many applications that you can already build and perhaps use in your research. And this is something that's still more in the area of ongoing development and research. Okay, so a crash course on what the fundamental idea of the semantic web is. We break down complex information into simple sentences using a model called the resource description framework. The fundamental idea is that however complex the information is you want to communicate, you can perhaps, it's a simplification of things, but from a pragmatic perspective, it works very well. We can reduce it to very simple sentences consisting of a subject, a predicate, and an object. Then what we do is we associate each element of these so-called statements with URIs, so we give unique identification to each element of our statements, and these might relate to ontologies, for instance, to describe the semantics of what a relation means, or provide a unique identifier to an artist that we're talking about, so that it's easier to actually combine information that lives in different places on the web. So this is essentially turns the model into a web scale, a global web scale database. So we're no longer talking about just data sitting in one resource, but we're talking about data that is distributed across the web and interlinkable using this simple model. And then when we combine these RDF statements, essentially we get a graph, we get a node, an edge label directed graph, which is essentially a semantic model that constitutes to the underlying model of the semantic web. Now, a node, an edge labeled graph in itself is a fairly weak semantic model. We can associate the elements of this graph with ontological definitions, which can make it a strong semantic model. Right, so how would we go about doing that? First, we could use, for instance, first order logic to capture and describe the meaning of things. So here's just an example of how could we describe some information about an audio content. But the problem is that we have to take into account that we would like to do reasoning at some point over this data, perhaps. And first order logic is only semi-decidable, so it's too hard for reasoners. We can't have algorithms that are guaranteed to terminate and give us all the inferences in reasonable time. So the way the semantic web gets around this problem, that ontologies, semantic web ontologies are based on description logics, which are reduced formalisms that have favorable computational properties in comparison to first order logic. I'm not going to go into too much detail about that, but what's interesting to know perhaps is that each ontology language that is used on the semantic web has a corresponding description logic which supports reasoning over the data. Okay, so once we cleared all these basics, I would like to tell a little bit about the music ontology, and in particular show this core model, which is actually not my invention, but I created this diagram because even a number of years after the music ontology had been published, I realized that a lot of people ask questions or create models because that are not quite correct, because the model is fairly complex if you just look at the examples and the actual published ontology schema. So perhaps what I would like to highlight in this model is that in this context, the music production workflow is represented as a four-layer conceptual model where we have events. So all these yellow nodes in the graph are representing events or processes that allow us to transition between the conceptual layers of what exists in the domain of music. So we can start from, for instance, a musical work, which is an abstract representation of the composition, perhaps that's in the mind of the composer, or perhaps something that's not yet written down, or maybe it's an improvised piece that's generated or that's emerges on stage. So this concept is enables us to represent that. It might be preceded by an actual process or an event, a composition event. And once it's performed, it produces sound, which is a next layer in our conceptual model constituting a particular type of musical expression. So we can attach metadata about a particular performance so that we can describe, let's say, expressive performance related concepts. Now, once that performance is recorded, so we move on using another process or another event, which is an actual process of recording, that produces some sort of signal. It might be a digital signal or an electrical signal once it's recorded using a microphone and perhaps processed more. And this signal can be then released, which will become a record, so we can represent the various elements of, let's say, a vinyl or a CD. But at this stage, we are talking about just manifestations, so these are not concrete items. Like this is, I'm not talking about the actual CD that you own, but a particular release, so that there are basically common, there is something common across all the instances. And there would be a different manifestation if that album is perhaps remastered. So we're not talking about the same signal again. That's the reason why we have this fourth layer. Before we can go to the actual physical item, which might be a CD that you particularly own, that might have certain properties. Now, the context where this model comes from is the library, essentially. So the four-layer fundamental conceptualization is based on the functional requirements of bibliographic records, which already defines these four layers. We adopted it to a music domain and extended it with the set of events which enable us to transition between these layers. Now, one might ask the question, why it's actually important to have these different layers? Because we might have different context around a piece of music at each of these stages of the workflow. So that we might have different metadata that's more relevant to the work, or we might have different metadata that's relevant to the actual item. So we have, for instance, when we talk about an audio file, we have maybe even signal properties if we're interested in that. And later on, I become interested in capturing what happens in the production process. So to capture the contribution of the producer and the engineer to a piece of music, because I felt that this is very underrepresented. So extended this model with studio-related concepts, which I will come back in a minute. Okay, so the way it's used in, for instance, in the music web application that I showed before, is that we take data sources and represent them using concepts from the music ontology. So some of the information comes from music brains, which provides us a set of identifiers which we can associate with music, with concepts from the music ontology, and get more information from DBpedia, categorize them using Diago categories. We can gather links from sources like Last.fm, or tags like from sources like Last.fm, and we can get content-based information from acoustic brains. We also been looking at analyzing articles, what people write about artists, and apply natural language processing to find links based on that. So the fundamental framework or the basic steps that we would do in an application like Music Brains, once somebody searches for an artist, we would resolve the artist name to a Music Brains identifier, which can be linked to DBpedia. And then once we get more information from DBpedia, we link it with the various data repositories that we have, which include similarity data pre-computed from acoustic brains. We have data about tags, which we use, for instance, to identify the typical mood that an artist uses, for instance, or a database that contains links based on what academics or perhaps bloggers write about artists. That's something that we haven't quite extended yet. Okay, so Other applications of the music ontology, of course, include describing more the audio content. So here's just a couple of things that we might do with this framework. So perhaps we can describe content-based information such as chord or the tuning. We can capture much of the detail of the production workflow, or we can describe the use of audio effects. And I'm going to show a demo of how that is put in practice a little bit later on. So one of the first things that might be interested in to a lot of people who work in music informatics or music information retrieval is the description of various content-based features that are often extracted from audio content. And what current state-of-the-art representations usually provide is just some kind of data schema for capturing the actual values. But in order to support research reproducibility, for instance, or to be able to say whether a particular feature for a particular source has the same meaning as another feature computed by another tool and deposited in another repository, we need to know something about how these features were actually computed. So we can perhaps create a taxonomy which is adapted to different tools. Here's an example of looking at how features are classified, let's say by the MIR toolbox. This is a classification in Essentia. Here's a classification that comes from a literature. And they are diverging. So one of the additions that I've recently worked on with a colleague at Queen Mary on creating audio feature ontologies is to separate the idea of how we represent the features themselves and how we actually combine them and how we create a taxonomy. Because an issue is that there will always be differences between how different tools categorize features. So one way of resolving that is to create a flat vocabulary and then enable tools to use tool-specific classifications, which are all rely on a fundamental model. So what we found interesting and important to model instead and use it as the core of the audio feature ontology is to represent the actual concept, so what an audio feature is, what an MFCC, for instance, is, which can have different models that we might want to represent. So we're talking about the actual mathematical model or the algorithm that that expresses that model, and it can have different implementations. So again, we're looking at a four-layer model, and the reason for this is because we might want different metadata elements to be associated with different concepts at the different layers. So for instance, it's important to separate what algorithm we're talking about from the actual implementation, because if it's in different languages, there is no guarantee that the computation will exactly do the same. There might be bugs in one of them, or there might be issues with how data is represented in different languages. So there is some importance, maybe it's not highly important, but there is importance in representing the difference between them. And then the actual computation instance captures the code execution process, so we can know which version of a tool has been used on what operating system, so we can attach all this metadata to the actual execution context. So if a bug emerges, for instance, in a way a certain OS computes data, we can verify that. So this is an important model in the ontology which allows us to capture a lot of the prevalence about computation. And then to be able to then match different implementations together, the ontology provides a mechanism to link an actual operation sequence to feature extraction tools, so we can describe perhaps what are the actual processes involved, and we can look at the differences between them using the data. So the important thing here is that we can link the output to the actual details of the computation. So I would like to just give you a very brief example of how this sort of data would be serialized then at the end. So here's a bit of turtle, which is very common, which has been commonly used by the semantic web community, but nowadays JSON-based formats are often used. And I'd just like to briefly highlight that essentially this is a data format that can be consumed as traditional JSON data, which is very common in the context of REST-based APIs, but the objects are typed and linked to ontologies, and the field names are also linked to ontologies. So if this data is consumed, we can be sure what the values represent, what tools have been used and how, and essentially there's different ways of consuming it. So we can load this data, for instance, into a graph database and query the information rather than hard coding essentially the meaning of the different fields that are being used. This is more of a detour, but I would also like to show just that we can essentially find out, for instance, what computation steps were involved in computing a particular feature, even if we just have the instance data, because the ontology describes this, and this can be done in a tool-specific way. Okay, so I'm going to skip that, but I implemented a service a long time ago, which provides a way to upload recordings and look at how this would be represented using the audio feature ontology, but this needs to be updated to the newer one, so incorporate all these new elements that I was just talking about. Now, the other large extension of the studio ontology, of the music ontology, is the studio ontology, which captures the details of the record production process. Now, the reason why I got interested in such a process is because, well, partly because I have a background in audio engineering, and I often felt that this field is not represented enough, so there's a lot of emphasis on, let's say, the performers and the composition, and there are mechanisms and notation to basically capture music and these particular elements of music. But when we're looking at popular music, what an engineer does in a studio is a very important and a very substantial contribution to a piece of music, but there is no mechanism to actually capture that and notate this contribution, perhaps. So this is what the studio ontology enables us to do, and the fundamental core model I would like to pull out for the studio ontology is this two-layer model, which enables us to describe how recordings are manipulated, and what happens if I just go back very quickly to this core model of the music ontology, what happens essentially between the performance and the recording and then the release event. So some people, especially when Gopala was talking about describing Indian music, it came up that maybe in some cases, describing this production workflow in such a detail is not necessary. So I fully appreciate, of course, that in some applications, this is too much detail. So there are shortcuts in this model, so you don't always have to use it. But then when you would like to capture even more detail from the production process, it's actually not sufficient. So what the studio ontology does is it extends that model with this two-layer model where you can describe a series of signal transformations in two layers. So you can have an event flow, which are essentially correspond to a set of processes, such as mixing or transformation, like the application of audio effects, and also describe the signal flow, so we can associate metadata with the actual things that have been used in that process. So we can describe, for instance, the kind of microphone that have been used, or the position of the microphone in the recording studio, or the configuration, whether this was configured as a particular kind of stereo arrangement, or some other way. We can describe the mixing process and the various details of the devices involved. We can describe the transformations, so a series of production procedures corresponding to, let's say, applications of audio effects, and the actual things involved in those processes. So the parameters of audio effects, for instance, whether they are hardware devices or simulations on a computer, this all can be described and captured using this model. And later on, I will show some applications where we build plugins which describe data in this particular way. Now, talking about audio effects, we also found that it's important to model audio effects more conceptually as well, because there might be different things. Similarly to the computation of audio features, the way we would like to describe and conceptualize audio effects. So again, interestingly, and this is an observation that emerged to me after a number of years, a roughly four-layer model fits very well to this case as well. So we can, for instance, conceptualize an audio effect as an echo, as an actual physical process. And we just talk about this phenomenon in this case, and that's actually the physical process that we would like to model, or a reverb, or reverberation, again, as a physical process. Now, we can have different computational models. So for reverberation, we can have, let's say, a feedback delay network or a Schroeder-Mohrer reverberation algorithm. This is essentially trying to reproduce the same physical process, but using different models. And maybe the accuracy of these models and how well they correspond to the actual thing that happens in the physical world might be different. Now, there can be then, once we selected an actual model or an algorithm, we can have different implementations, and there might be differences in the implementation as well. And finally, we arrive at the concrete layer of this conceptualization, where we talk about the actual device or the actual plugin, for instance, that executes that model, let that be a VST plugin or an audio unit or a hardware device. So it captures all these different possibilities that might happen in record production and what might happen in the studio. So when it's all combined, essentially we have a large framework of ontologies built around the music ontology, which can capture a lot of detail about music production. Now, of course, evaluation of these models is quite complex, so I would just like to briefly mention a particular mechanism that I use to evaluate parts of the music ontology and parts of the studio ontology. This is using topic modeling, because I was interested in how well such models fit to how people describe music production. I looked at 8,000 articles from Sound and Sound, and using a topic model, basically try to associate the concepts that are grouped around certain topics, such as audio effects, or sampling, or microphones, and see how well the ontology matches the structure within these. Now, one important thing, or one interesting thing that a topic model allows us to do is to resolve ambiguities from language. So, for instance, if we know that the term shotgun occurs in the microphone's topic, then obviously it refers to a polar pattern rather than an actual gun. So it's something where natural language processing comes quite handy. And so what I found when extending, essentially coming up with a score to look at how well the ontology captures these terms, I essentially found that extending the music ontology with the studio-related context provides a much better fit to the particular sound-on-sound text collection, text corpus, rather than just using the music ontology model alone. Another interesting experiment I would like to mention is to try to build ontologies describing instruments which take instrument samples into account, so we can perhaps tune the structure of ontologies or refine the structure of ontologies by looking at the different properties of instruments and how they are being played. I don't have time to cover all this in detail, but you can have a look at the paper cited there. But in conclusion, about all these ontology frameworks, what I really learned after trying to model all these different domains within music is that perhaps there isn't an individual single ontology that could be maximal for all applications. And that relates very well to Arrow's impossibility theorem, which basically looked at it in the context of social sciences. What could help and what could resolve some of these ambiguities is to design a federated system of ontologies. And that's the approach that we took in the recent refinements of the audio feature ontology. So the ontology allows us, for instance, equally well to describe outputs coming from VAM plugins versus Essentia versus the MIR toolbox, because it doesn't put hard constraints into a taxonomical organization of the output of these tools, but it allows us to become flexible, but still everything that's defined in the ontology somehow relates to a core conceptual model that allows systems to interpret the data and match them, perhaps figuring out whether two values are equivalent from two different tools or not. So this is just one example of where this has been put into practice. Right, so the next part, I move on to the next part of the talk, which is about music and emotions. And this basically stems a bit from a project that I've been involved in a couple of years ago, where we try to help BBC producers to find music in a large catalog based on similarities. So the first, that's why I just flagged up very briefly the similarity ontology, which isn't my work, but from Kurt Jacobson. So we first try to look at modeling similarity and then structuring data according to that and put it into an application. Where we would recommend similar songs to producers. Now, the idea here was that we can have documented production music catalogs, which are expert tagged, and we've been looking at whether it's possible to create a system where we can use commercial music examples in order to search a production music catalog, or whether we can create a system which helps tagging a commercial music catalog for which we don't have the metadata or we don't have the same quality metadata as what we can find in an expert curated production music catalog. So we put a simple version of this system into practice at the BBC. I'm not going to cover the details, but we get quite good responses just based on a similarity, but we wanted to go further than that, and a common request was essentially to try to find music based on mood. So one of the problems that this system essentially tried to solve is to navigate this collection to find a particular piece of music that might fit, let's say, a mood or the mood of a documentary or another piece, perhaps something with radio. And that opened a new line of research that I feel is very close to this area of semantic audio, which is to try to predict the mood for a particular piece of music. And this can be done two ways. So we did some work with colleagues, both on using social tags and on using audio-based analysis. So it's just a very simple idea, of course, that if you have enough tags, you can compute the similarity between tracks just by embedding into a vector space model and then simply compute similarities between these vectors. Then you can, of course, restrict the tags that you are used that are related to genre or motion or the topics of interest that you're interested in. And then, of course, the ambiguities in the use of words can be resolved using latent semantic analysis. So this is actually fairly simple and standard. But there is, of course, different problems with this. So for instance, the data collection can be very large, in which case we might want to reduce or organize somehow ontologically the tags that we are using, or perhaps want to use the audio content for tags, for tracks for which we don't have enough annotations. And that's a common problem in recommendation systems. So the work we've done to that end, first using tag data, essentially collecting tag data from Last.fm, using a vector space model and various techniques, including multidimensional scaling, to try to map the tracks into some sort of model that would be a representation of how similar the tracks are given the tags of interest, so in this case particularly mood, and we used a model proposed by Thomas Erle at Sari to map essentially tags into an arousal valence space. And we did it for two different sets of collections. We did it for curated collections and tags coming from users of Last.fm, so crowdsourced versus curated tags. And we then try to compare whether the curated tags provide better prediction. So the idea here was that it's essentially create a system where we take advantage of the expert annotation and then compare how the model behaves when we use, let's say, the expert annotation to predict tracks from the same collection, or use the expert annotation to predict the value of arousal valence for another collection, and essentially try the different variations. And it turns out that it does actually make sense to use expert annotation even to predict tags for commercial music tracks, because generally, both for valence and arousal prediction, the curated tags outperform the crowdsourced tags. We then looked at cultural dependence, of course, as well, and perhaps dependence on genre. So here's just an idea. This was just a very brief study we did, comparing Greek and non-Greek listeners and their perception of both Greek and non-Greek music tracks. And we found that, particularly when people are looking at music coming from a particular culture, people tend to separate or annotate tracks differently if they are familiar with that culture versus the cases where they are not. So when it comes to music from a particular culture, people who recognize that music better, they have a higher accuracy of perhaps predicting it. They definitely behave differently. So based on this, we then looked at how can we incorporate ideas from, let's say, the culture or the genre into models that predict the emotion from audio content. And we came up with different ways of essentially incorporating genre information. Now, we talked about already, it came up in Anya's talk, for instance, that music can, of course, become, be, can be part of more than one genre. So rather than representing genre as a simple category, we try to simply use a genre vector, so try to predict how much, what is the likelihood of a song becoming being part of a certain genre, and then incorporate this information into models that predict the mood. And it turns out that generally, if we, so this is the baseline, if we include genre information, we can improve the prediction of mood from audio. So the next thing I would like to talk about, still in this context of mood-based systems, is how can we help the audience to communicate with the musicians or with the performance using mood. So traditionally, essentially, the music performance scenario is usually like just a one-way system, so the performance cannot really be easily influenced by how the audience perceives their music. They perhaps try to look for cues, perhaps try to look for the reaction of the audience, but we would be interested in how could we facilitate this process using technology. So this piece of work was in collaboration with a French vocal group who already tried to do this using non-technical means. So they tried to distribute, for instance, pieces of paper in the audience, and they had to write what kind of music they would like to listen to, and they tried to then improvise based on the direction of the audience. But of course, this process is still quite disconnected. So we've been looking at together with them how could we create a system which enables real-time feedback from the audience and perhaps enable the musicians to change how they perform based on what the audience feels or what the audience would like to listen to. We created the mood conductor system together with Mathieu. So there's a collaboration with also several students at Queen Mary. And we created a system which you can run on your mobile phone. You can choose either mood-related words or a position in the arousal valence space, which is a two-dimensional model I already talked a bit about that's commonly used by psychologists to represent emotion. And the system collects all the votes from the audience and creates a visualization. So the visualization represents essentially clusters of people suggesting a particular area of emotion, and the size of these bubbles dependent on how many people vote in a particular region, which all works dynamically. And of course, then the musicians have to practice a little bit to learn the interpretation of this visualization, but it tends to work really well. So we had several concerts with this system and generally got very positive feedback from both the audience and both the performers. So just to show you a brief video of this, this was recorded at one of the concerts at the Barbican. Thank you. Right, so there are, of course, several.
Oh, well.
It all happens at the same time. There are, of course, several challenges with systems like this. For instance, with large audiences, maybe the amount of data that comes in is overwhelming, so that system needs to be able to adapt to the amount of data that comes in and the size of the audience to create a sensible representations for the musicians. So this was one aspect that we spent a lot of time working on. But it was very interesting to observe the behavior of the audience. So at the beginning of a concert, it's quite often that there is a game-like competition between people who try to influence the musicians into, let's say, being scary and depressive or happy and calm at the same time, which sometimes proves difficult for them. So rather than just representing the responses as bubbles, we created a system which tries to project a smooth trajectory over the emotion space from the responses, so do a sort of longer term analysis, essentially fitting a model onto the incoming data and try to give an idea of the direction where the audience is moving. And that way, this worm, which is a little bit similar to the performance worm that Simon Dixon created a long time ago for visualizing expressive performance. Essentially, this sort of worm follows the audience in the mood space, and if musicians decide to follow that, it provides them an easier target so that they can perhaps more smoothly move from one type of performance to another, which is quite difficult if there is, let's say, an abrupt change. Suddenly, a group of the audience members win and they suddenly have to shift the way they play. So that could be quite difficult. So overall, this system works essentially by representing mood semantically, collect information from the audience, and then a visualization client can be fed to a video screen and the projector so that the audience can also see the visual feedback. And there is an intimate connection because each individual data point is still visualized as a little bubble, so you can actually see your own contribution, which we found quite important. So up to about the end of 2014, there were 7 concerts where we evaluated different variants of that system, particularly about how we cluster the data and how we visualize it and the different models for visualizing the audience data. And based on the feedback from the audience, we implemented more and more refined models, essentially, within the mood conductor system. But what I would like to say overall is that both the performance and both the musicians found the various aspects of the application quite easy to use and pleasing. So I think it's an interesting direction, and perhaps more applications which look at live performance could be interesting. So it's just a quick note. Now, another iteration, or perhaps another system where we use more or less the same technologies, is an installation called MoodPlay, which allows you to create a mashup from a large music data set. So then we combine the audio-based and tech-based analysis that I was talking about before with the mood conductor system. But instead of having live performance, we choose songs from a large database of music for which we automatically generate mood annotation and then create a perhaps interactive mashup that people can work, play around with. So this was exhibited at various places in London, and it's not very well visible, but people generally enjoy it. So usually they play with it, and it creates an interesting atmosphere. So this is more like a fun application of some of the research that I showed before rather than something very practical. But during some of these sessions, very interesting, we received very interesting suggestions of applications of how this could be used. A lot of people would be interested in using it as a way of recommending music, or people suggested that this might be useful in music theory, but we haven't really explored these aspects of the system yet. And then the last topic, and I'm not sure, Xavier, if I still on time, the last topic I would like to quickly cover is this idea of semantic music production. So as I mentioned at the beginning, my background is from audio engineering, and I talked a lot about ontologies for representing the music production workflow, both in a broad sense and both in practice in the recording studio itself. But of course, the fundamental aim of that work is to help the people in the production process, help both the musicians, but primarily the producers and engineers, in order to simplify their workflow, or perhaps to make to reduce the barrier to entry in this field and allow musicians who don't know so much about technology to control things in a recording studio using more perhaps easy to use interfaces or high level semantic terms. So that's sort of the goal of this line of research, essentially to simplify the task of the engineer, or perhaps provide help, to provide tools. And what I found is that the ontologies and the semantic representation of the data helps a lot to create complex systems, and also helps a lot to create research systems to enable essentially finding out the mechanisms or the ways people use these tools and collect data that then enables us to create models and allow advanced controls of effects. So here's one example of an application where we create an adaptive audio effect, which essentially looks at audio features. We can control, essentially, we can associate various audio effect parameters with different sections or different types of events that happen in the music. So how is it different from conventional audio effects? Essentially, there are, of course, adaptive audio effects already, which perhaps do simple signal analysis, but they are usually not aware of higher level or more complex musical concepts like, for instance, keys or chords or various sections of a recording. They usually look at just very low level signal level properties like loudness and so on and so forth. For instance, a compressor can be thought of as an adaptive effect already. So the application that we created inside is in fact a compressor. So you have the standard compressor parameters, but you also have musical parameters, and you can configure different settings for the compressor depending on, let's say, whether you're processing the chorus section, or you can enter a chord pattern and associate that particular chord pattern with a particular with a particular configuration of the effect, which essentially speeds up the automation. So typically this kind of task is done by, let's say, automating the parameters, but that's something that still needs to be done manually, and usually it's not related to the musical concept. So what this plugin does is that looks at the content, finds, for instance, what instrument is being played, finds structurally homogeneous segments in the music using essentially the existing algorithms from MIR research, and a lot of it is implemented as VAM plugins usually. Finds chord labels, find onsets, for instance, and you can select these musical categories associated with the particular settings, which are then recalled at every time when that particular chord pattern or that particular segment occurs in the music. So this is one of the examples I would like to mention. This, of course, is then built as a VST plugin, and we tested it, and it's actually quite useful, but of course more thorough evaluation needs to be done for this particular idea. But the plan is to continue with other types of effects. But then the other interesting way of controlling audio effects is rather than having the engineer or the user to really learn what the different parameters of an audio effect mean, simply control it by high-level semantic terms. Now, we could achieve that by perhaps looking at how experts usually do it, but there are lots of dependencies on the genre, or there are lots of subjective differences. So we decided to try to do this using a data-driven approach, and we built all these representation and ontologies into a system which allows us to collect data from how engineers use an audio effect and how they associate the different settings with different musical contexts and features. So I would like to show a brief video of this. It's called the Semantic Audio Feature Extraction, or SAFE, project, which is a collaboration.
Hi, I'm Sean.
Birmingham and Queen.
Don't you just hate it when you can't get your drums sounding quite punchy enough? Or when those strings just don't have that air that you desire? I know I do. That's why we here at the DMT Lab created the SAFE plugins. The SAFE plugins aid in music production by allowing you to save semantic terms such as warm or bright. These terms are then collated from all users and are available for you to load in your project. Let me show you how to use them. First, let's start off by using the SAFE distortion to make this bass warmer. On loading the plugin, we need to open the metadata panel and fill in the relevant information. This information helps us categorize the audio features that you'll save, which will then make the loaded terms better in the future. There, all done. When this symbol shows, terms will be saved to a server. When this symbol shows, they will be saved to your own computer. Let's make this warm. Oh, tweaking that gain. Tweaking that drive. Now that's sounding warm, let's type it in the descriptor box. If we want to save multiple descriptors, we can separate them by spaces. Creamy. Now we're all ready to hit save. Remember, the audio has to be playing in order for the plugin to analyze it. Loading terms is very simple. We'll just press load. Then we can search for our desired descriptor. I'm going to search for punchy. Then we can load that up. And we're done. Oh yeah, that's really punchy. Now you know how to use the SAFE plugins. Go ahead and give them a try. The more terms you save, the better the loaded terms will become. And remember, stay safe.
Right, so what this system allows us to do is both learn about how people use audio effects and then also allows us to share, maybe perhaps you can call these presets, but to share essentially how different terms are used in different contexts. So they can be different if you produce different genres. And we looked at the data. Found that, for instance, people use different terms depending on their geographical location. So producers in New York or producers in London would use different terms, or if they produce different genre of music, they would perhaps use different terms. So it's actually quite important to capture all this metadata that I was talking about at the beginning using ontologies. And I'd just very briefly like to show how the actually underlying ontological modeling works in systems like that. So we essentially capture transformations as processes or events. It conceptualizes events in this sense. This is a bit more detailed view on the two-layer model of the studio ontology that I showed before. And for instance, we can say, we can track the workflow of what processes a particular signal went through. Here's an example of a simple rule where we define just in first order logic, if there's an event which consumes a signal, so if there's a process X or event X which consumed a signal Y and produced a signal Z, then we can know Y is derived from Z. So we can capture that knowledge, very basic knowledge, in either in an ontology or in some kind of rule-based system. So for instance, here's the description logic capture of this simple rule which we can embed in an ontology, but there isn't a lot of reasoner support for these sort of compositions yet, but of course the ontology can capture that. But we can, for instance, use a simple rule language like N3, which basically says if this set of patterns observed in a graph, then this graph can be implied. So essentially, we can still build these simple rules into systems. So just to give you an example, if we have data describing a set of transformations, we can track essentially what sort of processes a given audio signal went through in that particular context. So for instance, we can look at one of our productions and look at the series of transformations that it went through. So this is really just a very simple example to show how Sparkle query can be used given this data coming in from the system and some information derived from inference rules. Or we can find, let's say, the origin or the original recording of a particular processed signal. So in terms of data analysis, this is a paper we submitted last year which looked at essentially the terms that are most commonly used in the context of different audio effects. You see that, for instance, for the compressor, punch, smooth, vocal, these are terms that are very commonly used. Interestingly, sofa is there, I'm not sure why, but there are all these ambiguities. And then we can also group, for instance, equalization curves and how they associate to different use of semantic terms. So for instance, warm or bass or boom usually results in an EQ curve like this, or thin, clean produces something in higher frequencies, for instance. So we can basically let users to just use these terms and configure their effects, and we also can learn the relationship of where they are, what genre they work in, and so on and so forth. Okay, so I think I should wrap it up. I had a bonus topic which I thought if I have time to cover, I would, but I won't because I really run out of time. So what I'm going to do is to skip all this and go to the very end and talk about some future ideas. So what I learned from all these years of using ontologies is essentially flexible ontology-based systems can really help a lot when it comes to building complex systems and then can simplify the way we analyze data. So we can basically, rather than trying to figure out how information all comes together, we can use structured queries, can really simplify things quite a bit. But of course, there is additional effort that's needed to understand the ontological models themselves. And perhaps rather than just quickly do some data structure, quickly design some data model that is good for the particular piece of research that you're doing, it probably requires a bit more effort at the beginning to put your data into a structure that is described by ontologies. The other thing I would like to perhaps propose or suggest is, so a lot of the things I was talking about is either rule-based, and a lot of people criticize these approaches that, well, a lot of things should be interpreted probabilistically. I think it's true, but putting prior knowledge into probabilistic models could actually be a very interesting direction, and using logical representations could actually help in model selection, for instance, or helping the ways of how we incorporate priors better into statistical probabilistic models. Okay, so I would like to wrap up the talk with a shameless plug. I'm chairing a conference in London that will be between the 23rd and 25th of August. This is the 2017 edition of Audio Mostly, which is an ACM conference typically looking at interaction with sound. And the particular theme that we're focused on this year is participatory and interactive sound and music experiences. The conference will be co-located with the third Web Audio Conference, so there will be a week-long event in London between the 20th and 25th or 26th of August. So if you're interested, please come, please submit papers. You find the call for contributions on the website. And if you have any question about it, come and talk to me after, later in the afternoon, perhaps.